future seems to have had for so many people. Just randomly, how many people out here tonight have, before tonight, have not seen Back to the Future movies?
Oh, I've seen it at least 100,000, 100,000 times. 100,000 times. More than that.
Well, that's, you know, less than 20 or maybe 10, or I don't know. Not, you know, it's been seen and seen and seen again. And whenever, you know, the children saw it when we opened. And some of you have grown up and had children and now are seeing it, and it's kind of easy. Keeps going on and on and on.
It never dies, man. It always will be the best.
It is amazing. Another aspect is so many people have come up to me and said that when they saw it when it was kids, it influenced them to become a physicist or an engineer or a technician or a doctor. That's extraordinary. You know? So I'm very, I guess, proud to be a part of such.
You're amazing, Christopher Lloyd.
So, Mackenzie Eastman of Thousand Oaks, California, would like to know, what was your favorite Doc Brown moment in the series?
Well, one that comes right immediately to mind is when I'm Marty, where this is my shop. I built a model.
It hasn't been to scale.
A good model. And as I take the DeLorean, demonstrating to Marty what he's going to be doing, and it shoots me out, it goes, falls on the floor, and goes into a pile of rags, and sets the rags on fire. This is, you don't go talking about it at all. But, as I see it going, something like that. I don't know where that came from, but I like it. I like it.
Now, I think it's interesting that in all three movies, you only appeared with Leah Thompson twice. In the first movie, and then you and Leah never,
never crossed time, space, time zones.
But you spent time with Leah.
We're friends, and we've worked together in two or three other films. I don't remember which ones, but apparently that's.
One was Dennis the Menace.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
That's right.
I gotta look that up.
I looked the way I did because of what he did. What she did.
All right, so we're pointing fingers now, right? Oh. Well, let's see. There's a Roger Rabbit question here.
Who framed Roger Rabbit?
You only to reprise your role in Roger Rabbit.
Huh.
That was a lot of fun. And he was so, there's a sort of classical kind of evilness about him. You know, the way I was made up. And the costume, the whole look of it, you know, the whole thing. I enjoyed that.
Another question that was from Roger Ebert, which was, what exactly was Judge Doom?
What was Judge Doom
under all that?
You know, I've never been asked that. If we have a future, I'll have an answer.
Oh, well, that would be our next movie to play.
And what I was going to ask before was, there were 4 years between Back to the Future. So when you came back, were you happy that you were coming back to be Doc Brown again?
For which one?
Part two.
Part two.
Yeah, yes, I have mixed feelings. I have mixed feelings because, well, the first night shooting Back to Future 2, it was all night shooting. There were two things that kind of terrified me. One is that they were going to reshoot the end of Back to Future 1, where Marty goes, you know, lightning strikes, and Marty goes back and forward, or whatever.
Aww.
I did a whole thing where I jumped for joy and shrieked and shouted, and so, you know, and I just really, really didn't know if I could get that going again. And then the other thing, I think that night, was when they had the shot, I'm up on a ladder, repairing or doing something on the lamp, you know. And then I need a wrench. And the other me, an identical me from another time, standing there, and I asked him to give me the wrench, but I don't look at him. And he said, sure, something, and he doesn't look at me. I just didn't know how that was going to work. But it worked.
You've done good. You've done good.
Let's see, a gentleman named Mark wants to know, what do you do at a yellow light?
Oh. Wow.
you've played a lot of iconic characters, and I guess Reverend Jim would be your first.
A Million Ways to Die in the West.
What is that in your memory, in your list of characters? Where does he?
He's really up there. Huh. He's in my cloud. Yeah.
So true.
No, because, yeah, that was, that, I had just left New York because I had done another film that had opened. It was really successful. I got an invitation to come to Hollywood by an agent, and I couldn't pick up dust in that area in New York. So the offer of an agent in LA, I wasn't even there. And I signed with him in 1976, and we're still signed.
Wow, that's awesome.
He's had a lot too. Not usual that things last that long. You want to repeat your question? What was the question? Or did I just ramble? I think we're good. All right.
How did you get taxi?
How did I get taxi? He's paying attention.
Yeah! You're the two fans.
I came out and nothing was happening. I didn't want to do a series. I didn't want to do a sitcom. I came out from New York and solved. I'm not going to do sitcom. And I had an attitude because in New York theater, it's a different world. And to compare the day, to go give up a theater, to go to LA and do sitcoms? Really? I mean, where's your integrity? Where's your soul? I mean, it used to get hot. I mean, when I first came out, I went to some parties where those who were accepting L.A. were also the company of New Yorkers who would never think about coming to L.A. actors. And it would get intense, unpleasant, and come pretty close to, you know, getting really bad. It was a real attitude, and I kind of shared a lot of that, I have to confess. So I did not want to do a sitcom. And my agent very naturally would say, go up and meet these people for this sitcom. And he knew my feelings, but he said, just because you never know in the future how it might be important to meet them. Mm. So I conceded to do that, although I felt I was being conned. And he sent me the script for Reverend Chip, and I looked at that. I had a friend who lived in Laurel Canyon who was cleaning up in his yard, bushes and thickets, and he found this denim jacket with a peace sign on it.
Oh my God.
Tattered, old, and weather-beaten.
That's awesome.
And that's what I wore. I had a pair of blue jeans with holes. Worn and all that.
From, like the ones you're wearing now?
Somewhere, probably in the old wardrobe. And then sneakers from an ex-father-in-law. all threadbare and all that. And there's a conclusion and all that. And when I went in to meet everybody, and as I left, they told me to wear that Monday. So that's how that started. And then I did one show. I was just asked all to be a guest, where I marry on the Rev, the neighborhood so-called spiritualist of some sort. And I have a cameo part where I marry Lothka to a prostitute, American prostitute, so that he can get a street car. I wonder what Trump would do about that.
Oh my gosh. Oh. I had no idea he'll say that. That's great.
Borderline something or other. But yeah, that's how it started. Thank you. Remembering.
The memories.
You know, there's a gentleman out there, I hope it's a gentleman, his name is Thor.
Thor.
Okay, there's Thor. Who would like to know, if time travel were real, would you go to the past or to the future?
Right now, I would go to the future. I'd like to come back in 15 years, although I'd like to see why that far away. I won't quite make it. Or 100 years ago, to see how all that's happening today works itself out. I mean, I gotta see that.
Yes.
I remember I used to read, at a time I used to read about something that they say that 10 years from there, or 15 years from there, or whatever, this and that, whatever. And today, I read that, and it said in the next 10 years or 50 years or whatever. And suddenly I'm realizing I might not be here. That seems like a weird thought, but I'm sure I'm not alone, and that perception when you get to be a certain age. Interesting. Doing an independent film, which none of you have ever seen or will ever hear about again. And the script, I haven't been in L.A. for very long. I left New York, and I was in a whole different kind of place. And I didn't feel things were really looking good, you know. I didn't feel there was a surge to obtain So, where was I?
Mexico
City. Yes, out of Mexico City. And I know what something is thinking just now. And the back, my agent sent me the Back to the Future script. And I had just agreed, or was about to agree, to do a play in New York, and I thought that's what I should be doing. Go back to where I started, go back to my roots, to the theater, which is I have been doing, you know, practically all my life. I thought that, you know, I'm being sucked into the whole Hollywood weirdness syndrome thing. You know, go back where you belong. So I kind of skipped through the script, and then I just threw the waste of the basket. One of the great career moves that fortunately didn't come to pass. And a friend that I was with at the time said, "Chris, your mantra has always been, leave no stone unturned. All my time in New York, if I saw it, you know, the acting from the backstage, which was in the show business, which were two weekly newspapers for people in the business, and a big cast, you know, lists of the things being cast at that moment. When we were getting ready to start shooting the first one, or some time during the second, somewhere, and the kind of started, and he came up to me, and I'm not a test. I am not big with publicity and interviews and stuff. I'm not known for being very forthcoming, if you will. And so Bob came up to me and said, I think he said, "You know Michael Clastron?" And I said, "Yeah." And he sort of in one way or another asked me if I recommended you, and I quite unequivocally said yes. So why Bob came up to me, I don't know, but that's what happened. And consequently, you did Back to the Future
2 and 3.
And we also worked on a film before that.
The Dream Team.
So I'm so glad to be sitting here with somebody I can sort of trust.
Well, let's see how the night goes.